Rising up the ranks from trainee to the boardroom is a pipe dream for many. But some dreams come true. One man who knows the journey well is the chief executive of Roche. Severin Schwan started at the bottom in 1993. Today, he's a lot higher up the ladder, but he never left it. 2021 marks his 28th year at Roche, a doctorate in law, but he made his name in pharma. Schwan became the head of the crucial diagnostics division in 2006. He was handpicked to take over the whole company 2 years later. He says he's fascinated with Roche because a company can create significant value for society, saving lives and improving the quality of life for millions of people and their families. Within his first year as boss, he made the company's biggest ever acquisition, buying Genentech for $47 billion. It was a big bet on the future of medicine, making Schwan one of the most influential leaders in the sector. Today, on Leaders with Lacqua, we meet Severin Schwan, the chief executive of Roche. Dr. Schwan, thank you so much for speaking to us. How have you changed as a leader since that day in 1993 when you joined Roche?
It's a journey, right? You develop over time, and it's a series of experiences which hopefully make you a better leader. I remember very early on when I joined Roche as a trainee in the early 90s, I had then the opportunity at a very young age to take over people leadership responsibility. I became finance director in Belgium at the time. So it was really from zero to 100 in terms of people responsibility. And what I really discovered, and I think it still influences me today, was the power of working with a team and the importance of having a motivated team. If you have the right people around you, you have so much more impact. When you're at university, this is a bit of an abstract concept, right? And you have your colleagues and you work together. But if you can form a team and if you have a common goal and you're aligned and you enjoy doing what you do, I mean, this can make such a difference. So the awareness of leadership, working with people, providing the right environment for people, that has been a very important element early on. When I became CEO shortly after the financial crisis in 2008-2009. I remember very well, at that time, investors were very risk averse. It was all about cash flow, cost restructuring, etc. At the time, we had some great opportunities in research and development, and we were behaving almost anti-cyclically, and we were investing into research and development because we thought it was the right thing for the long term. I mean, looking back today, I'm so glad we did that because, this is all the medicines and diagnostic solutions which are driving our growth today. It was the right decision. But the point from a leadership point of view I wanted to make is that I as a CEO had the privilege to think in the long term, and that was very much related to the special capital structure we have at Roche. I mean, Roche is still controlled by the founding families, and they truly, truly think in the long term, in generational terms. And I think good leadership is a lot about doing the right thing in the long term and not just optimizing in the short term. And that is also something which really, really has influenced me. You know, I just became CEO. I had to do something which nobody wanted to do, really. I mean, at least from an investor's point of view. And I saw that it was important and it was a good decision. And therefore today, still today, when I think about shall we take this decision or that decision, I always ask myself, what is the right thing in the long term?
But that's what a moral decision. And going back to how you build a team, you know, what's the secret sauce to have a great team around you? Is it people that are different from you? Is it people that challenge you? Or is it people that want the same things ethically?
It's a lot of things. I think from a leadership point of view, what I believe is that in a business like ours, where it's a lot about innovation and creativity, right? We have to turn cutting edge science into new innovative medicines and diagnostic solutions. I think it's very, very important to give people enough space. Creative people need space. They need air to breathe. They need freedom. If you tell creative people what they have to do, then you get exactly what you tell them to do, right? And you don't get something new. So I think good leadership has a lot to do with giving people a lot of freedom so that they can put their dreams into reality. And you have to orchestrate it, and you have to align it, and you have to give it direction, and you need a common sense of purpose. But I think that's something very, very important. And often, you know, we put people into little boxes and tell them exactly what they have to do. I think you get so surprised when you give people enough freedom, and it's positive surprises.
What's the most difficult thing about being a leader?
Letting go. I mean, we all think that we can do the things better than other people, right? And you know, as a result of that, you always try to intervene, and you always try to tell people how they should do it. And I think leadership has a lot to do with having trust in people. And that also means, and that's difficult, that also means that you are consciously willing to let people fail, and that it is acceptable that people fail. If you truly trust people, then you also need the strength to accept failure, and that is something which is not so easy. It's also not so easy for me, and I've learned that over time. That yeah, you might have improved something here or there with your input, but on balance, you probably prevented more if you always told people and if you always intervened. So letting people fail, I think is tough, but I think it's important.
Coming up, pharma and the pandemic. What lessons has Severin Schwan learned in 2020?
It's unprecedented times. And actually, we as Roche are at the very forefront in the fight of this pandemic.
Industry is suffering somewhat of a reputational crisis. In recent years, it has more often been attacked for drug pricing than praised for its discoveries. But with the speed these companies have reacted to the COVID pandemic, they may well have a chance to redeem themselves in the eyes of the public. In the quest to develop a treatment to end the crisis, researchers have overcome challenges that would typically take years, if not decades, to beat. Still, there are signs that this rehabilitation is conditional. Any displays of vaccine nationalism could prolong the pandemic and feed the public skepticism. Roche's Severin Schwan has expressed concern about a lack of international coordination on securing tests and drug supplies. Dr. Schwan, what has the pandemic taught you about yourself in lockdown, on your priorities? How have you so far lived through the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, it's unprecedented times. And actually, we as Roche are at the very forefront in the fight of this pandemic, both on the pharma side, developing new medicines, which hopefully help us to cope with this pandemic, and also very much on the diagnostic side. And what is really good to see, if I look back, is that we were able to to react very quickly. And it's good to see that even a big organization like ours can respond very fast and can respond in an agile way. And I think we have touched that in a different context, in the context of leadership. But I think, again, this has to do with the special setup of Roche, which is a very decentralized setup and a very decentralized management model, which actually is very much in sync with this leadership approach in general, where we trust in people, where we empower people, where we delegate decision making as much as possible. And what that allowed us is that before we at the executive committee or myself even realized what we could do, there were hundreds of people out there who were already working on specific solutions with new medicines, with new diagnostic tests, and could respond in a very, very fast way. So I do believe if you have a crisis like this, it's a big advantage if you have a decentralized setup where people have real authority and don't have to kind of escalate every decision 25 times up and 25 times down, but just get to work, get something implemented for their respective function or in their respective countries. And that worked out very well, I have to say.
How do you see the pandemic actually affecting your industry? Is there a danger that too much work, I mean, I guess you could say it's not enough, but a lot of work is being done for COVID-19, and so other parts are actually being left behind?
That is a risk. And we have clearly seen that during the lockdown. So everybody was focusing on COVID-19. And as a result, patients were not going to their doctor anymore. They were not going to the hospital. And the diagnosis got delayed, treatments got delayed, and that, of course, has medical consequences in the long term. Now, it has improved. People are returning to the hospital, are returning to the doctor, but we are actually not yet back at normal levels. We are perhaps at 80-90% of what we would have seen before the COVID crisis. And that is a concern. That is a concern. We have to do everything to get this pandemic under control. And I'm proud of all our people around the world of what contribution we make here. But let's also be very clear. Most people continue to die from other severe diseases. And we also have a responsibility to serve those patients and make sure that they are served well.
Do you think there's a more collective recognition about how much pharmaceutical companies actually do? Is there more on your shoulders now that in the last 7 to 8 months, we've all become virologists?
Yeah, in particular on the diagnostic side, I should say. If I look at the learnings from this pandemic, on a societal level, people have recognized how important the diagnostic infrastructure is for a well-working healthcare system. And also what we saw during this pandemic was big differences even between developed countries. I think that's a big learning, and that's a good thing, because we are definitely now better equipped for the next such crisis than we were a year ago in many countries around the world. So in particular on the diagnostic side, I think there's much more awareness now than only recently.
Do you think it changes the social contract between a citizen and the government? And again, what does that mean for pharmaceutical companies?
I would hope that in countries where perhaps healthcare was less in the focus, now people realize how important that is for societies, and that countries really see healthcare not only as a cost, but as an investment, which is important for the prosperity of a country. And related to that, I think what is also very important is the solidarity, to not leave people behind, that you have properly working insurance systems, for example, so that everybody who needs a medicine or a diagnostic solution actually gets it. And in a crisis like this, I mean, this is a not new topics, right? That's topics which have been around and have been discussed for a long time. But now it really comes to the surface, and there is much more focus on it. And I do hope that, you know, with all the troubles we have because of this crisis, there will also be some positive learnings we can benefit from for the future.
Coming up, the future of pharma. What actions is Severin Schwan taking as chief executive to keep Roche on the cutting edge?
We have increased the investments on the diagnostic side because there will be more demand for diagnostics, and of course we have to make sure that we can meet this demand.
Beyond COVID, what is the future of the pharma industry? Severin Schwan tells us that scientific advancements in prevention and diagnostics could save millions of lives if governments commit to take action even when we're not in the middle of a public health crisis. Early detection of cancers might not make as many headlines as a new vaccine, but it might save more lives. And Roche is a leading diagnostic company as well as a drug maker. But Schwan says the pharma industry is still lagging behind in digitalization and the smart use of technology. How does Severin Schwan intend to lead Roche into the future?
How does the pandemic actually change your plans for Roche in terms of what's in the pipeline? I mean, given all the changes that you know, laid out just now, how do you see Roche evolving over the next 5 and then 10 years?
I don't think it will change our principal strategy. I mean, we will remain very focused on innovative medicines across different diseases and diagnostic solutions. And actually, we will invest more into data, the digital opportunities and respective tools. You know, we have already been in infectious diseases, so we will continue to invest into this area. And certainly we have increased the investments on the diagnostic side because there will be more demand for diagnostics, and of course we have to make sure that we can meet this demand. So we adapt our strategy, but I don't see a fundamental change in our strategy.
Will there be more demand for biotech? Will there be more demand for vaccines? Or how do you see that evolving?
Yeah. I mean, there's already a lot of demand for biotech and new innovative medicines. I mean, many diseases can not yet be treated. I don't see a fundamental change on the medicine side. On the diagnostic side, I see a change. And I see a change for the better because there is still enormous opportunities to improve healthcare delivery. Currently, if I look at it from a societal point of view, in most countries, there is a lot of investment into acute diseases, and there is not enough investment in the prevention of diseases. And with diagnostics, early diagnostics, screening programs, etc., I think you make healthcare delivery much, much more efficient and also cost efficient because it's so much cheaper to intervene in a disease early on. And then also you save people from a lot of suffering. And that, I think, is perhaps an opportunity, a window of opportunity we have now, because everybody talks about diagnostics. So suddenly people talk about being prepared, people talk about screening, people talk about building the right infrastructure. And I think that is then also the basis for going more to preventive healthcare and intervening more early than just focusing on late stage diseases, where often it is too late and where it's also very expensive for healthcare systems to take care of these patients. So I would hope that we have a shift here in this respect.
Given that shift that you're talking about, what would be the most difficult question? Is it who pays? And if you have to, you know, pay at the start, then you take a risk actually that you're paying for nothing if that person
I think that it needs a mindset change in the population, and as a result of that, in the behavior of politicians. Because you know, one problem in our democracies is that politicians are only elected for, say, 4 or 5 years, right? So if you invest into prevention, right, then it's actually your successor who will benefit from such a program. It's beyond your own tenure, right? And therefore, a politician wouldn't do it. You know, if there's an acute crisis, if people are acutely ill, then a politician is under pressure to react. You know, if a mother with a small child gets breast cancer, then this is all over the newspapers, right? It's on the front page. And why did society not take care of this breast cancer patient? Now, this is very important. But actually, if you would have invested money into the prevention of breast cancer or into the prevention of cervical cancer, where actually we do not enough and we could do much more, then you could prevent these cases in the first place. And if this gets part of the understanding in a society, right, then politicians will adapt, and then they will be willing to change the system. So what I would hope for is that the thinking overall in the society shifts to a healthcare system where you kind of, you know, do not want to get ill in the first place, where you prevent a disease rather than putting all the focus of resolving the issue when it's too late.
Which seems so logical and yet so difficult to do. Do you think the pandemic would be a catalyst to change that?
Because I think because diagnostics has become a bigger importance, and because countries are now investing into a diagnostics infrastructure. I give you a very specific example. So now in many countries, the countries are investing into a diagnostics infrastructure simply to cope with COVID-19 testing, right? Because you need highly automated systems to just simply cope with the testing requirements. Now, at some point, of course, the need for COVID-19 testing will go away, right? I mean, at some point we will overcome this pandemic, even though it doesn't feel like it at the moment. At some point this pandemic will be over, that's for sure, right? But the infrastructure will still be in place. So imagine, then you have all these hospitals and labs who sit on this infrastructure. And now, of course, the hurdle to use this infrastructure, for example, for screening programs, will be much lower because the investment has already been made, right? Now, all you need is the screening tests on top of the expensive infrastructure. So the hurdle from a cost point of view and everything around it, you know, you also need the capabilities, you need lab personnel who can do it, etc., is much, much, much lower. So cervical cancer is a very good example. There is a test out there, it's called HPV. You screen for a specific virus, and we know that by screening women for this virus, you can reduce the incidence of cervical cancer. You know, we should all do it. We should all do it. There is no medical question. If you think in the long term, there is no economic question. The reason why we have not done it in many countries is because the diagnostics infrastructure is not here, and because it would cost a lot of money to build this infrastructure, and because the politician hesitates because it will be the successor who benefits from this infrastructure, right? Now the infrastructure is in place, so the hurdle to get those screening tests into this infrastructure and therefore shift to a system where you go more for prevention than then taking care of these patients, in this case, patients who get cervical cancer, right? I think is lower, and the chances are much higher that we see a shift here. So I think that there is a good chance now.
Dr. Schwann, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you.